Hi folks, welcome to the shop. I want to go through the setting up, sharpening, and using the low angle jack, the number 62. Fairly new offering. Now the difference, the primary difference between this and this typical bench plane that you see at the end of my bench is that it doesn't have a chip breaker. Its blade is set in place with the bevel up. So when you're calculating your angle of attack, or the angle that you're planing wood, you have to do it a little bit differently. Anyway, we'll go through that. Now, this also has an adjustable toe plate instead of moving the frog. So I'm going to suggest that when setting it up, you're going to want to take that apart and clean it as well, or else the packing oil that they ship with may solidify over time and make it hard to operate. And I'm just using paint thinner. Breaks that down a little quicker. I'll take the lever cap off. Take the blade out. Gotta clean those up as well. And if you loosen this front knob, take that out as well. Push that bottom toe plate out. Now, you see they have a good, a fair bit of support surface underneath here, so I've seen some low-angle blocks that have a toe plate that moves, and it only touched on the perimeter, and you can actually tighten it and deflect that sole piece, that toe plate. So this is, they've overcome that problem. Up. Actually took that toe screw right out of there so we can get at it a little easier. Now you notice that the blade has grooves milled in the bottom and they mate into that piece attach to the adjuster knob. And then you have all those extra ones just to compensate for wear on the blade over time. It's quite a specialized blade. It wouldn't hurt to keep just a little bit of oil in there, so I'm not going to bother taking that apart. Okay, you want to make sure that the all tight in the handle. Okay. A little bit more. This is patterned after the Stanley number 62, which supposedly was a plane made popular by those who would come around and resurface butcher blocks. So the idea is that it's a lower angle of attack, but if you do the math, it really isn't that much lower. And I'll explain why. Let's get another rag. If you consider that a standard bench plane, like this, the bedding angle of the blade, simple math, but I'll write it down anyway. The blade is bedded at 45 degrees by the frog. That's this thing right here. And because the bevel's on the bottom side, and there's no bevel to speak of on the top side, then you're actually planing at 45 degrees. On a low angle block, or a low angle jack, your bedding angle is 12 degrees. But because your blade is positioned with the bevel on the top side, then when that is put in place, you have to factor in the bevel as well, which on a typical plane is going to be 25 degrees. But most everybody will go through and apply some micro bevels. I'll walk you through that. So you're going to have at least another 5 degrees in microbevels. Well, if you add that up, you're talking 42 degrees plus, and I say that just because some people actually go more than 5 degrees. So you're comparing 45 degrees versus 42 degrees. You have a 3-degree difference. I can't really see that being a huge advantage. So I discount any advantages on a low angle plane in terms of making it any easier to plane. Now it does make for faster and easier adjustment with when you're closing your throat down to control tear out. You can simply have extra blades to change your angle of attack. So if you want to increase the angle of attack, you can simply have a second blade that has a steeper bevel on it. So you can do a lot that way. But it comes down to personal preference. What do you like? Okay, now we put this back together. We'll put that toe plate in. And the machining is really nice on this too. It's good and close. No, I didn't clean that off. And this is brass, so brass on steel lubricates itself. Drop that pin in, and then just line the hole up so that you can get that threaded bolt. Now we'll pull that back. Snug that up. Okay, those edges feel pretty good, so I wouldn't bother going through and doing anything to them. I don't feel, there's a little bit of a burr right there. I'm gonna take that off. If you don't address this now, it'll end up leaving a mark in the wood. I'm gonna bring that toe plate just back until it's in line with those side pieces. This may have happened in transport. Just a little bit of a burr on there. I'm always filing away from the sole so that you don't end up inducing the burr on the bottom side. Now there's a nick right there too. This is plane has been out of the box. Must have been on display or something, but just make sure I don't feel anything on the bottom side. Rest of it feels good. All right, we can set that aside for a minute. Now let's go over and dress this blade. We're going to do the standard sharpening on that, which means even with the bevel down, we're going to introduce the back bevel. I'll start it, or I've got to produce a back bevel before I can sharpen. So. With the steel rule on the edge of the 1,000 grit stone, set that on the opposite edge, stay within a quarter of an inch of the edge, 3 fingers to distribute the pressure as evenly as possible, and I grab that corner right there and that corner right there with my other fingers, and I kind of put this part of it into the meaty part of my palm just to help steer it, and I prefer to go forward and back. You can do this, which just takes a lot longer. This you can move it around a little bit quicker. Again, stay within a quarter of an inch of the edge. Light to moderate downward pressure. You don't have to push excessively hard. Let the diamond do the cutting. Now, before we go any further, I just want to see how much work I'm going to have to do. Thank you. Okay, so we're already all the way across, if you can see that. Now, the caution we have to be aware of here is there are grinding scratches from the foundry that go all the way to the end. And by doing this little back bevel, it prevents us or keeps us from having to polish all of this surface, flatten and polish. But the purpose, the reason we do that is to get rid of the grinding scratches so they don't go all the way to the end. By doing a little back bevel, we're cutting down through them, but we just have to make sure that we cut deep enough to get below those scratches so they don't end up translating into grooves at the edge of the blade, which would leave ridges in your board, and you could tell because your shaving would be serrated as you plane. Something that typically happens over time as the blade edge breaks down, but you certainly don't want to start that way. Now, typically this is going to take maybe a minute and a half, unless you happen to get a blade that's really out of flat, but this one was good, and most are. At least they're good enough that you can do this ruler trick quite quickly. Now, I've got a 10,000 grit stone here, so I'm going to use it just to speed the process up. The first thing I'm going to do is go in, I'm going to use the 300 grit side of my diamond plate to make sure that this is flat. And I'm putting this 10,000 in here just to make the transition a little bit easier. I don't always do that, but like I said, it was sitting here, so I know I'm going to use it. Make sure that you run a little bit of hone rate on that too, just because it lubricates it, makes it easier to slide this blade over it. Now I'd say, since your shaping has already been done on the 1000, all I'm doing is just getting rid of the 1000 grit scratches right on that little strip. So maybe a minute and a half. The area is not very big. Stay within a quarter of an inch of the edge. Same pressure you applied on the previous stone. Now the last thing we'll do is we'll take that up to the 1000 grit polish. Thank you. Thank Jake for the mental reminders. Just a few seconds every time you use the stone, and then you never let it get so far out of whack that it takes any longer than that. Now this is just removing the 10,000 grit scratches, replacing them with the 16,000, which is as high as we need to go. All of this is in the prep phase. You do it once and you don't have to repeat it. And I'm not hurrying because we're filming. This is just typically how long you'd expect it to take. Okay. Now we'll actually do the sharpening. So we'll come back over here to this 1000, find the primer. Actually, got some dirt on there. I'm just going to remove that. Set that on the primary bevel. And again, thick blades give you a wide primer, makes it easy to find. So I've got four fingers on the cutting edge, and I hold the blade. I pretty much hold every blade the same way. You modify it a little bit when you get into the narrower blades. But I'm using that hole in the middle of the blade as an indexing point. I'm actually squeezing the blade like this and then jamming my thumb in there to tie the two fingers together, hands together. Four fingers right on the cutting edge. Just rock it a little until you can feel the primary. Then raise up slightly. One, two, three, four, five, six, 7, 8, 9, 10 seconds. Feel a burr, runs corner to corner. Then come over here to your 16,000. Repeat the process, except instead of coming up 3 or 4 degrees, I'm going to go just a little bit higher. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. At the end of 10 seconds, a little bit of downward pressure in one corner for 3 seconds with my index finger, and then opposite corner, which in this case would be the left, with my pinky on my left hand. So I did this, and then I did this, just enough to feather the outside corners to help remove plane tracks. Now there was a piece of grit or something on there, you could hear it scratching. Final step is just to get rid of the any burr that remains. Just a couple of seconds of work, all it takes. Get another piece. towel because I want to make sure that that's good and dry. Don't want any rust. You want to come in there, Jake, and show them how nice and shiny that strip is on the back. You pick it up?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, make sure there isn't any burr on that lip, on this edge right here. And I'm just going to go in there and file that. And then I'll go back on this side. Just to make sure I meant to check that earlier. Okay. Now we'll make sure that that toe plate is far enough back that we're not going to bump into it. Set that blade in place. Get it to engage the teeth in the adjuster knob. There, it's sitting down. Put the lever cap on. Now, I don't want it too tight because I've got to adjust it. I've got that blade out quite a bit, so I'm turning the adjuster knob in a clockwise rotation. Actually, it's easier sometimes if you look up against a light-colored background. I'm just going to clean this off. Okay, now the blade appears to be parallel to the sole. Maybe it's off just a little bit, so I'm just going to push it actually a little bit tight. Here's where you might want something like a little brass hammer and just tap that slightly. That went a little too far. Okay, now I'm going to tighten that lever cap up just a little bit more. Okay. Now, give me a second to clean up this mess. I'll grab a piece of wood. We'll try this out and see how it works. I got a piece of pine and a piece of maple. We'll try both. So we know the blade is close to the sole, and since this isn't figured wood, I don't need to have the throat closed down tight. But I am going to bring it down to a little more comfortable setting, which, if you want to see it, it's probably a 16th. A little bit of wax in the sole to reduce the friction. Now we can retract that and get a little thinner shaving. A little bit more. Tighten this up a little bit. Retract it further. Now the shaving's a little bit heavy on one side, so I'm going to tap that blade over just slightly. A little heavy on one side. That's better.
Okay.
Now, feel that. Nice and smooth. I'll try it on a piece of maple. Now, if I had a situation where I had some figure in there, or reversing grain, all I have to do is come in here, loosen the front knob, move that lever until that throat, and I'll put a white piece of paper behind it so you can see. You see where the gap is? You able to pick it up?
Mm-hmm.
And that is going to offer lots of support to the wood fibers just ahead of the blade. So instead of allowing it to lift and eventually break that fiber, that leading part of that toe plate puts downward pressure on that fiber and won't allow it to lift. So that's your low angle jack. And if it's a lighter plane, if you were to compare it to the 5.5, which is approximately the same length, it's, I'm not sure what the exact weights are, but I would say that this one is probably going to be a pound and a half, maybe even 2 pounds lighter. Probably says it on there, but I haven't read it. Anyway, that's your low angle jack. It's a good, nice offering from Wood River. Hope you enjoy it. See ya.